Free speech under fire. I'm Michael Smerconish in Philadelphia. America is having trouble speaking just when we most need to have a national conversation. And what's proving difficult is establishing new boundaries that don't completely shut down dialogue. In Sacramento, the NBA Kings play-by-play TV announcer was fired from his radio job and resigned from his TV role. Grant Napier caused a firestorm when responding to a tweet from NBA player DeMarcus Cousins. Cousins asked, "What's your take on Black Lives Matter?" Napier then replied, "All lives matter, every single one!" exclamation point. Many cried foul, including Chris Webber, who said, "DeMarcus, we know and have known who Grant is. The team knows as well. I've told them many times. They've seen it. They know who he is." There is a history here. 5 years ago, Napier defended then LA Clippers owner Donald Sterling when he made racist comments. Napier said Sterling couldn't be racist because he'd hired Doc Rivers and Elgin Baylor. This time, Napier apologized. Then there was Drew Brees. The New Orleans Saints quarterback initially said that kneeling during the national anthem disrespects the flag, referencing Colin Kaepernick's sideline protests from 2016.
"I will never agree with anybody disrespecting the flag of the United States of America when the national anthem is played and when I look at the flag of the United States. I envision my two grandfathers who fought for this country during World War II, one in the Army and one in the Marine Corps, both risking their lives to protect our country and to try to make our country and this world a better place. So every time I stand with my hand over my heart, looking at that flag and singing the national anthem, that's what I think about. And in many cases, it brings me to tears, thinking about all that has been sacrificed."
Again, the response was immediate. Many athletes took issue, including LeBron James and Richard Sherman. Saints safety Malcolm Jenkins responded with a pair of Instagram videos, one of which he later deleted. Jenkins said this, quote, "We're done asking, Drew. And people who share your sentiments, who express those and push them throughout the world, the airwaves, are the problem. And it's unfortunate because I considered you a friend. I looked up to you. You're somebody who I had a great deal of respect for. But sometimes you should shut the F up." Brees apologized via Instagram, writing in part, "I take full responsibility and accountability. I recognize that I should do less talking and more listening. And when the black community is talking about their pain, we all need to listen. For that, I'm very sorry. And I ask your forgiveness." Enter Ellen DeGeneres. She tweeted and deleted. What did she regret? Apparently saying this, quote, "Like so many of you, I am angry and I am sad people of color in this country have faced injustice for far too long. For things to change, things must change. We must commit ourselves to this change with conviction and love." Some objected to her use of people of color as a word choice. Others thought that she was milquetoast. Ellen then issued a tearful apology.
"I know I'm not gonna say the right thing. I know that there are gonna be a lot of people who are gonna be in disagreement with what I say, but I have a platform and I have a voice and I have always stood for equality. I have always wanted to be the voice for people who felt like they didn't have a voice, because I know what that feels like. And maybe you don't agree with how it's coming out, but you have to understand it."
Here in Philadelphia, Inga Safran is the Pulitzer Prize-winning architectural critic for the Philadelphia Inquirer. She wrote a thoughtful essay which included this. "You can be appalled and heartbroken by our country's deadly racism and yet still quake at what the damage to downtown portends for Philadelphia. Racism is built on strong foundations. The momentary satisfaction of destroying a few buildings does nothing to remove those structures. All it does is weaken our city." Unfortunately, her thoughtful analysis was initially accompanied by a headline, which she did not write, which said this, "Buildings matter too." The newspaper issued an apology saying, "While no such comparison was intended, intent is ultimately irrelevant. An editor's attempt to capture a columnist's nuanced argument in a few words went horribly wrong, and the resulting hurt and anger are plain." The New York Times drew fire for publishing an essay from a sitting U.S. senator. Republican Tom Cotton wrote in support of the government using troops to quell rioting, saying in part, "Some elites have excused this orgy of violence in the spirit of radical chic. calling it an understandable response to the wrongful death of George Floyd. Those excuses are built on a revolting moral equivalence of rioters and looters to peaceful, law-abiding protesters. A majority who seek to protest peacefully shouldn't be confused with bands of miscreants. Protest of the Times, having published Senator Cotton's thoughts, came from both outside and inside the New York Times. A number of employees expressed their disapproval of the piece. More than 800 staff signed a letter protesting its publication. One tweet came from the New York Times Magazine writer Nicole Hannah-Jones saying, "I'll probably get in trouble for this, but to not say something would be immoral. As a black woman, as a journalist, as an American, I am deeply ashamed that we ran this." Taking note from the sidelines, veteran journalist, multi-Emmy award-winning broadcaster Jeff Greenfield weighed in. He said, "About Senator Cotton's op-ed in the New York Times, if you don't want an op-ed page that prints views you strongly disagree with, you don't really want an op-ed page, you want a my-ed page." For sharing his thoughts, Greenfield then became the brunt of enmity, including from New York Times opinion columnist Jamel Bowie, who replied saying this, "Free and open discourse carries an implicit within the accepted bounds of democratic society." Now the New York Times has said it won't run Senator Cotton's essay in tomorrow's print edition as planned. By the way, I want to know what you think. Go to my website, This Hour at Smerconish.com. Answer this week's survey question. Should they be running it in Sunday's print edition? Now, here are my thoughts. If we choose to disengage, we'll fall into a trap established by those parties more interested in division than unity. Maybe we can learn a thing or two from a viral video. Emmanuel Acho is a former NFLer who this week published a 9-minute video titled, "How to Have an Uncomfortable Conversation with a Black Man." It's been viewed more than 6.5 million times. The video is simple in its presentation. It's just Acho looking straight into a camera, addressing from a black man's perspective such thorny issues as white privilege, systemic racism, white-on-black crime versus black-on-black crime, and why can an African-American say the N-word when a white person never can? Here's a clip of what he had to say on that subject.
The N-word is synonymous with oppression, execution, and subordination. Black people took something that was meant and originally used as evil, and we turned it into a term of endearment. So white people, I submit that you can't, shouldn't, and nor should you ever have a desire to say that word, whether quoting a rap song, a movie, or anything.
On my radio program this week, Acho told me why he made the video in the first place.
There is a clear racial divide. Let me stand in this gap and try to connect my white brothers and sisters, Michael, to my black brothers and sisters. And it's obvious. It is so obvious, Michael, that my white brothers and sisters across America are ready to help. They just don't know how. And so I wanted to give them a crash course on how.
That's the lesson. Yes, this national conversation is long overdue, but beyond the talking, we need to listen, not shut out, even if it's sometimes uncomfortable. You don't need me to tell you, emotions are raw. People are very upset, more raw, more upset than I've seen in my adult lifetime. People want to talk about it. That's good. Sometimes they choose the wrong words, words that strike others as horribly insensitive. In that raw moment, the backlash is instantaneous and it can be harsh. The harshness stills further dialogue. And we're all poorer for it. Let's keep on talking. When the speaker errs, the listener should correct nicely. When the correction comes, the reply should be thoughtful. We not only need that form of constructive dialogue, we must have it. A house divided against itself cannot stand only through reasoned national discourse. Born from love, not hate, patience, not anger, can we achieve equal justice under law?